Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Ravening Deep by Tim Pratt. Narrated by Roman Howell. This title from Aconite Books is also available as a trade paperback and ebook and can be found wherever fine books are sold. Book 1. Prophet, Huntress, Thief. Chapter 1. The Prophet. There was a time when Abel Davenport looked at the sea and felt wonder. Now, as he stood on the rocking deck of his beat-up trawler, the Hydra, and watched a storm flick fingers of lightning toward him from the southwest, he felt only a sense of impending doom. But even that was mingled with relief. When the doom came at last, you were finally finished. You didn't have to keep fighting anymore. When the ship at last went down, it would stay down, and all would be quiet. A huge swell lifted the boat high and tipped it hard to one side, but Abel kept his feet. He'd been working on fishing boats since he was a boy, first going out with his father, who'd fished these same cold New England waters, and as an adult, he'd made his entire living on the water. He just hadn't expected to finish living before he turned 35. For years, Abel had run the Hydra with a crew of four, but that was before his mother's medical bills and funeral expenses, before the engine failures and shipworm, before the termites ate half the house and the bank ate the rest, before that terrible month this season when every haul brought in fish that were inexplicably rotting or had too many eyes or too few. He shuddered at the memory of a monstrous 4-foot-long monkfish and vestigial arms tipped by weakly gripping hands. He'd kept that one, overcoming his revulsion, hoping to sell it to some college professor or maybe to a sideshow, but it turned into unidentifiable slime and bones before the ship was halfway back to port. Abel had to let the other men go, one at a time, reluctantly, when he could no longer cover their wages, not even by cutting his own. You couldn't really make a living on a boat like this by yourself, but what choice did he have? He was sleeping on the Hydra these days, and only the kindness of the dockmaster, who'd known him for years, allowed him to get away with that. He was eating the fish he caught to stay alive, and selling just enough to buy bootleg whiskey and pay his dock fees. But he could see the way things were going. Down, down, down. When the storm came, and the other fishermen cursed about a lost day of work, Abel had unmoored the Hydra and set off across the eerily still waters, toward that massing wall of lead-gray clouds. His old friends, who mostly avoided him now, shouted at him to come back. It was too dangerous, but he ignored them. He told himself he couldn't afford to miss a day's work, nor Easter or not. But now that he watched the oncoming storm, he wondered if on some level he'd been hoping for a final disaster to end his dissolution. Still, he made the Hydra as ready for rough weather as he could, pulling up the nets, readying the storm sails, battening the hatches. He could try to run out of the path of the storm. Another swell picked up the boat, this time lifting it so high and dropping it so abruptly that Abel was sure the Hydra had hung suspended in the air for a moment. He crashed to the deck, heart pounding, and he suddenly very much wanted to live. Amazing how the closeness of death could clarify that. Abel crawled toward the mast as the first wave of cold rain passed over him, stinging pellets peppering the back of his neck and his hands, and instantly soaking his clothes. The ship groaned and pitched, and he rolled across the deck, unable to find his feet. The clouds were right above him now. The rain and flashes of lightning all around, the storm moving with fiendish speed. He crawled forward, reached a coil of rope, and began to tie himself to the mast. Abel had never received much formal education, but his mother had been a voracious reader, and she'd told him stories about the gods and heroes of the ancient world. Abel had named his boat after the sea monster Hercules killed, the serpent with 9 heads, because he liked how the beast kept getting up again, growing 2 new heads for every one that Hercules cut away. Abel liked to think he would be similarly indomitable in the face of adversity, if, he hoped, ultimately more successful. Now, though, he thought of the seafaring hero Ulysses, lashing himself to his ship's mast so he wouldn't be able to follow the beguiling song of the sirens to his death. Abel tied the rope around his waist, crisscrossed it over his chest, and finished the makeshift harness with a sturdy knot. His fate was literally tied to the Hydra now. If the boat made it through, so would he. If not, well, there were worse ways for a life like his to finish up, though he didn't much like the idea of sinking down into the depths, not since he'd glimpsed some of the unnatural things that dwelled there. Lightning flashed around him, and then, to Abel's wonder, bluish-purple light flickered along the railings of the boat, casting the scene in dreamlike illumination. He tilted his head back and watched a ball of coruscating light slowly roll along the yardarm. St. Elmo's fire, the old sailors called it. But Abel had never seen the phenomenon himself before. He'd heard this fire, which burned but did not consume, could be a good omen or a bad one, depending. A wave struck the boat, spun it, and the back of Abel's head cracked so hard against the mast behind him that he first saw black stars, and then only the blackness. Abel woke with a groan. There was something rough, irregular, and sharp underneath him, cutting into his shoulders as he shifted. Had he fallen asleep on top of a pile of oyster shells or something? He struggled upright, memory slowly returning. The storm! He opened his eyes and looked up into a clear blue sky, wisped with shreds of cloud, the sun casting its light nearly sideways, close to the western horizon. The storm had passed. The storm had passed him over. He was alive. He laughed aloud, but only for a moment, because his throat was sore and his lips were cracked and salty. His head hurt, his right cheek stung from a cut, his whole body ached, and there were scrapes and abrasions all over his arms and hands. He was going to turn into one big all-over bruise in a day or two. Abel looked down, expecting to find himself on the deck of his boat. But he was sitting on a shelf of a rock, or a coral reef? There was coral in these cold Atlantic waters. Northern star coral, he thought it was called. But that was found on the bottom of the ocean, and didn't build elaborate surface-breaking reefs like this. Abel's late uncle Jericho, a Navy man, had served in Hawaii, and had described the weird beauty of such formations. He'd brought young Abel a chunk of coral as a souvenir, and this rock was sharp and porous and looked strangely organic, just like that. Abel still had that piece of coral in his makeshift bedroom below decks on the Hydra. His boat! Abel struggled to his feet, untangling the wet rope that hung loosely about him. He looked at the water surrounding this strange island, and there was no sign of the Hydra. But there was flotsam there, a few weathered gray boards, a stretch of torn net, a length of canvas, and a mangled life preserver. He sank to his knees and stared at the bobbing fragments of his meager livelihood, then looked up and scanned the horizon to the west, shading his eyes from the sun. He couldn't make out so much as a dark smudge to indicate the possibility of land. He took slow breaths, fighting against a rising tide of panic. People knew he'd gone out into the storm, and when he didn't come back, they'd send out rescue boats. But would they find him? How far off his usual routes had the storm carried him? He didn't have food or fresh water or shelter. Abel got off his knees. Nearly dying had restored his desire to live, and living in this situation was going to require effort. He'd better take stock of what he did have and what he could use. He explored his surroundings, such as they were. The rocky outcropping he'd somehow miraculously washed up on didn't merit the name island. He was on a stony sort of platform that rose barely a foot above the surface of the sea, a space just big enough for him to lie down on if he curled up a bit and didn't mind being poked with sharp edges. An irregular tower of stone rose up beside that flat section, easily 30 feet high, pointing at the sky like a misshapen and accusing finger. He couldn't see around the tower or guess its diameter, but there was a small outcropping like a ledge off to his left, disappearing around the side of the spire, and ample footholds and handholds. Maybe there was more space on the far side of the tower if he could work his way around. If nothing else, moving would keep him warm and loosen up his tightened muscles. Abel climbed up the tower slowly, testing each foothold carefully, pressing his chest against the rock even though its hard ridges poked through his shirt, finding handholds with questing fingers, inching himself around the rocky pillar. It was easier once he reached that ledge and could shuffle along with surer footing. There was more space on the other side of the spire, an expanse of stone easily a dozen square feet, like a front courtyard before the tower. A deep tide pool stood in the center of the courtyard, suggesting this rock was sometimes submerged, which meant he should climb higher if he could. Abel dropped exhausted to his knees and looked into the pool, stomach already rumbling. The water was full of starfish in brilliant colors, bright yellow and deep blue and blushing pink. There were no fish there, though. No crabs, no mollusks, nothing he could eat. Well, he'd heard you could technically eat the arms of starfish, or anyway they wouldn't kill you, but he wasn't that hungry yet. He suspected he'd die of thirst before he had a chance to starve. Wait, the rain! The storm had passed, but not that long ago. He rose and staggered toward the tower, which on this side was covered in little buttresses and outcroppings and ridges, looking for puddles. And yes, there were a few deep depressions, high above sea level and full of water. He sniffed, grinned, and scooped the rainwater up with his hands. Every mouthful was gritty and sun-warmed, but it was drinkable. And though the water stung his salt-dried lips, he lapped until he was full. Refreshed, Abel looked up at the spire. It was larger than he would have imagined, bigger around than the biggest tree he'd ever seen, the size of an actual tower. Maybe he could climb up to the top and rig some sort of a flag or banner from the netting and rope and sail that floated around him. If he could create something clearly man-made, something that had a chance of being spotted from a distance, it might improve his chances. Or it might be pointless busy work, but even that would spare him a little longer from despair. Abel began to climb, even more carefully, since he was going even higher now. There were ample hand and foot holds, but this side of the tower was full of sharp edges that wanted his blood. He made his way slowly, working himself up and around the tower, following the easiest path. The seas were liberally dotted with uncharted desert islands and heaps of unnoticed rocks, but still, the formation was remarkable. The ocean here must be deep, which meant this was just the visible tip of some much vaster foundation that rose up from the distant sea floor. The tower-like structure was memorable too, but he'd never heard anyone mention sighting something like this, even from a distance. How far from his home waters was he? Too far to be found? He was about 2/3 of the way to the top of the tower when he found the cave. The mouth was roughly oval and big, about 5 feet high and 3 feet wide, with a small ledge in front. He knelt on that ledge and peered into the hole, then gasped. There was light inside, and at first he imagined some sort of mad sea hermit burning a driftwood fire. But then he realized there must be holes in the top of the tower, letting the late rays of sunlight shine through. Except this light had a peculiar greenish-yellow cast. Reflecting off scummy water, perhaps? Abel crawled inside the cave. The floor was still rough, but nowhere near as sharp as the outside, as if it had been worn smooth somehow. A few steps inside, the ceiling of the cavern sloped upward, and soon it was high enough for him to stand comfortably, even at 6'1". He followed the tunnel a short distance to a large central chamber, as big as the main room at the old homestead, and Abel frowned, taking in the space. The tower got narrower as it rose, so how was there so much space inside? He must have misjudged the spire's diameter, but then it wasn't like he ever got a look at the whole structure at once. Maybe there was a section that bulged out on one side. Abel stepped into the chamber and looked up, expecting to see holes in sky. But instead, the ceiling was covered in irregular blotches of some glowing substance, shining yellow-green. Upon closer inspection, the growths looked like starfish, ranging in size from smaller than his palm to bigger than his chest. But he thought they must really be some kind of luminescent algae. As his eyes adjusted to the dimness, more strange details revealed themselves. There was a big hole in the center of the chamber, about 4 feet across. Lucky he hadn't stepped on that. But he couldn't see how deep it went. He was more interested in the back of the cave anyway. What he'd taken for a rock formation now looked like something more intentional. A smooth, dark stone table, or maybe an altar, big enough for a person to lie down on, projecting from the back wall. Even in the low light, Abel could clearly see the bas-relief carving above the table. It depicted an immense seven-pointed starfish, as wide across as Abel's outstretched arms. There was a circle cut into the center of the starfish's body, the inside of its curve carved with rows of inward-pointing triangles that reminded Abel of the teeth of a lamprey. Starfish had mouths on their undersides, he knew, but not mouths like that. He shuddered, revulsion crawling up and down his skin. Who would dream up such a thing? There were other tiny drawings carved near the bottom of the starfish, a few on either side. They looked like crude human figures, kneeling, their arms reaching up. Abel frowned. If those were supposed to be people, then that starfish would be the size of, well, they didn't make starfish as big as whales, now did they? He shook his head. What strange and ancient seafaring people had come here and decorated this place? What forgotten god had they venerated? There was a long depression in the altar, and it was full of water, briny and dark. Abel leaned forward and thought he saw something glitter in the water, catching the barest hint of that eerie light. Abel plunged a hand into the water, surprised at how deep it went, his arm disappearing into the shocking cold up to his elbow. His questing fingers closed on something that felt like a thick chain. He pulled a necklace out of the water, its links made of gold, and his mouth went dry. That chain was heavy. If it was really gold, and if he could get it back home, that length of bright metal would solve most of his problems. He might even be able to get his home back, or at least make a start on it. A large silver and black medallion dangled from the end of the chain, a seven-armed starfish with a mouth of triangle teeth in the center, just like the carving on the wall, but in miniature. The amulet wasn't gold, unfortunately. It felt like carved stone, and he considered snapping the thing off and tossing it aside. But maybe it had value as an artifact. There were college professors and the like who'd pay for such things. Maybe at Miskatonic University up in Arkham. Abel's home village of Strasport was an easy day trip from there by car. He held the amulet up and watched it lazily turn in the eerie light. If he ever made it off this rock, at least he'd have some treasure to show for it. Necklaces were easy to transport, too. He dropped the chain over his head, letting the medallion rest against his chest. The chamber filled with water, rising around him with impossible speed, and he sucked in a breath as he was submerged. He spun, but there was no exit anymore, just smooth walls on all sides, carved with the sigil of the starfish god in every size from miniature to vast. Except they weren't carvings. They couldn't be, because their arms were reaching. Abel opened his mouth to scream, too terrified even to fear drowning. but then the walls and the starfish vanished, and he saw. Chanting multitudes in long, dripping wet robes, walking on a stony shore beside Blackwater. A man rising from a pool of water, gasping and reaching out his hands toward an identical man, or at least a mirror image, who pulled him out and embraced him. Horrid creatures, like people with the faces of deep-sea fish swimming through lightless depths, spears clutched in their webbed hands, great gouts and clouds of blood in the water, huge chunks of pebbled flesh floating on the surface of the ocean like rotting whale blubber. A distorted view of a dark-paneled room, as if seen through a thick sheet of curved glass, with a gray-haired, dark-eyed man in a neat suit entering through an unseen door and picking up a carved stone object from a shelf, then going back out again. Abel moaned, back in his body, or so it seemed. But now he was in a cavern surrounded by heaps of pearls and the soft glow of gold coins. Firelight flickering from torches on the walls, with unseen figures in the shadows all around, chanting, and the chant echoed and reverberated and filled the air.
Restore me, and be restored.
He blinked and found himself suspended in a watery void. Below him stretched a great seven-pointed starfish, and as he watched, its arms grew and lengthened and stretched until they seemed so long that they might wrap around the whole of the world. He couldn't tell if the starfish had become immense or if Abel had become very small. His sense of scale and proportion were baffled, and both space itself and his own mind seemed as pliable as saltwater taffy. In the center of that starfish, whose reaching limbs now stretched on all sides to all horizons, a horrible, squirming mouth opened, and the thing inhaled, pulling water into its maw and pulling Abel down with it. Abel woke again, this time on gritty sand. He winced preemptively, expecting spikes of pain, since that was what happened last time he woke up. But he felt fine. Better than fine. He felt wonderful. No agonies in his body and no clamor in his mind, as if he'd rested well on a soft bed at the end of a day without worries, instead of on a shore after a shipwreck. He sat up on the beach and looked east toward the ocean and the rising sun. He turned his head to look along the shore, where he saw a familiar pier and the tiny dots of distant figures going about their morning business. He knew this place. He was just down the beach from the docks in Strasbourg, where he'd spent most of his days for 2 decades. Abel was home. He had no real memory of the night before, apart from swimming. He'd somehow made his way across countless miles of open ocean in the dark, despite hunger and dehydration and pain. There was no pain now. His arms and legs felt strong, ready for a day of good, honest work. He wasn't confused. He wasn't frightened. He understood. His luck had turned. He'd been blessed. He'd been chosen. Plans and purpose unfolded within him, stretching out to the horizons of his mind.
Restore me,
a voice whispered in his mind, his suddenly crowded mind. He knew so much now, new truths bobbing to the surface of his mind with every passing moment. He knew about ancient depths and forgotten temples and bloody wars fought in a lightless abyss. He knew about the power and the priesthood he now held. He knew the 1,000 names of his God, his Savior, the most holy of which were Asterias. That which, when divided, multiplies. The ravening deep. Abel's clothes were in tatters, and one of his boots was missing. The cuts and scrapes on his hands and arms were gone, though, and he knew no bruises would surface on his body. That was the gift of his god. He took off the boot, removed the lace, and then tenderly lifted the gold necklace off his neck. The necklace didn't matter. It was merely a resource. The medallion was all he needed, the source of his revelation, a gift from his god, a holy relic. He removed the medallion from the heavy chain and strung it on the bootlace, then put it back around his neck, under his shirt, against his skin. He rose, gold chain in hand. He would nod and smile at any acquaintances he passed. They were used to seeing him damp and shabby, and no one would notice his interior transformation. He would go to the pawnbroker, who was well acquainted with Abel, especially in recent months, and drive the hardest bargain he could. He would make the broker throw in a sharp knife as part of the deal. He would rent a room, one near the water, one with a big bathtub. And then, in blood and salt, Abel would begin his ministry and gather his congregation. Chapter 2. The Huntress. 6 months later. Diana sat in the small office in the back of her clothing shop, going over the books and trying not to think of those other books, the ones in the Seeker's Library at the Silver Twilight Lodge, the ones in languages she couldn't read, but with letters that somehow squirmed in her mind's eye anyway. Diana had only been running her business for 2 years since selling the family farm and moving to Arkham in 1924. She'd used the money from her father's estate to buy a dusty old place called Emmy's Boutique and transformed it into the most successful women's shop in town. She'd always been interested in fashion and the way the right clothes could change the way the world looked at you and the way you looked at yourself. She'd renamed the shop Huntress Fashions in honor of her mythological namesake and cultivated a wealthy clientele. She'd been savvy about building her reputation, joining the Chamber of Commerce, the Women's League, and the Historical Society, and using them as opportunities to make connections. The people she met and the good impressions she made with her impeccable sense of style led to success after success. The only downside was that she had to dodge well-meaning people who wanted to set her up with their sons or cousins or nephews. She politely told them she had to focus on building her business, and once she was more established, she would have time to think about such things. In truth, she didn't know if she ever would think of them. She felt complete in herself, and took pride in her self-reliance. When she did think of sharing her life with someone, she didn't usually think about men, and while her ambitions were many, they didn't include motherhood. Maybe that would change, but for now, she had a plan, and she was going to follow it, and she was not going to fail. Or, anyway, she'd had a plan. Now she had doubts, questions, and bad dreams. Things had started to turn for her when local luminary Carl Sanford invited her to join the Silver Twilight Lodge. Diana's father had been a lifelong Mason, and she'd assumed the lodge was a fraternal order like that, albeit one open to women members. The only other order she'd heard of that allowed women to join was the International Organization of Good Templars, and Diana enjoyed an occasional drink too much to join a temperance group. The Silver Twilight Lodge wasn't devoted to temperance, though. Back then, she wasn't sure what it was devoted to, and when she asked, she got vague answers about heritage and history and ancient lore. The same sort of things her father's Mason brothers talked about when they had too many drinks. So, when Sanford asked her to join last year, she'd said yes with enthusiasm. The lodge was an important and exclusive part of Arkham society, and as a member, she'd meet rich women who wanted the latest fashions, and their rich husbands, who needed to buy them gifts, and gifts for their mistresses, too. Her business would grow, and she would build a secure future, one free from the constant uncertainty her father had suffered at the farm. Or so she'd assumed. Instead, after a few months at the lodge, she'd been given more responsibilities and seen incredible, terrible things. The nature of reality had shifted beneath her, and everything she thought she understood about life and reality was thrown into question. Horrors she'd never imagined teemed at the edges of her understanding. The question was, what would she do about it? Diana rose from the desk and stretched, groaning as her aching back unkinked. How long had she been sitting there? She'd closed up shop at 5, and a glimpse at the windows showed it was fully dark now. The days were getting shorter as autumn crept on. She'd always had a gift for disappearing into numbers and projections and possibilities. She'd done the books for her father's farm from the time she was 13. She liked numbers. They always added up the same way, and if they didn't, it was because you'd made a mistake, not because suddenly 2 + 2 = 5. Diana had always prided herself on being a hard-headed New Englander who only believed in those things she could see with her own eyes. The problem was, she'd seen things that no responsible person could believe. She trudged up the back stairs to her small apartment above the shop. She was saving up to buy a house, maybe one of the cute Victorians with cupolas and widow's walks. That had been the plan anyway. But how could she stay in Arkham now, knowing about the rot at its heart, presided over by charming Carl Sanford? Maybe it wasn't just Arkham. Maybe the whole world was like this, a thin patina of normality covering up the filth and horror underneath. She couldn't take responsibility for the whole world, though. She could only take responsibility for her own life and the things she'd done. Or the things she hadn't stopped others from doing. Those things followed her into dreams. Diana sat in the threadbare armchair that was the only piece of furniture she'd brought from the farm. The upholstery still smelled faintly of her father's pipe smoke, and though the seat was shaped to his body from long years of occupation, it suited her well enough, and was gradually shaping itself to fit her too. She liked the space she'd made for herself in Arkham. The shop below was chic, sleek, and elegant, all draped silks and shining mirrors, with dresses arranged on mannequins as smooth and pale as ancient marble statues. But upstairs, her living area was cluttered and cozy, with patterned rugs and overstuffed bookshelves and end tables showing off her antique shop finds, all lit by lamps with tasseled shades. She poured herself a glass of sherry. One of her wealthy customers had amassed a vast private cellar in the years before Prohibition, and her client brought over the occasional bottle in exchange for getting first look at the new designs from Paris. Diana sipped and sighed, and settled back in the lamplight, gazing at the dark window that overlooked the rear of the shop. Until 2 months ago, on the night of the ritual below French Hill, she'd felt so comfortable here. That was all she'd wanted, to find a place where she was beholden only to herself and could make a life to suit her. She'd managed it too, until Carl Sanford decided she was ready to advance in the order. She twisted her mouth, half rueful smile, half frown. It was her own fault. She'd been so eager. She could have stayed in the fringes of the lodge, enjoying the private dining room and bar, mingling with the other new members and hangers-on. But she'd never lacked for ambition. And once she knew there were levels she could progress through in the order, greater ranks she could attain, she was seized with a fervor to rise through those ranks. She thought that joining the higher levels would give her access to more rarefied company, more powerful people, and more opportunities to improve her position. And while that was true, she could admit now that she'd also wanted to rise for her own sake. Some was good after all, but more was always better. On the farm, she'd worn patched dresses and secondhand shoes. They'd often eaten no better than the pigs, and life had been a constant struggle of mending and making do. She'd dreamed of a better life, and the lodge seemed to promise that. A new world where she could excel and be seen and respected and appreciated. She'd heard the names of the various ranks of the order whispered. Initiate, Seeker, Brother of the Dark, Knight of the Stars, Keeper of the Red Stone, Guardian of the Black Stone, and many more with titles an initiate as lowly as Diana was not permitted to know. Some said there were 61 distinct ranks, with the highest being held only by Carl Sanford himself. Diana had expressed her desire to rise and learn the sacred mysteries after just a few months in the order, and though Carl Sanford had seemed amused by her enthusiasm, he had given her certain texts to read, later quizzing her on the information. Her mind was always adept at patterns and organization, and she'd easily retained the names of ancient gods and places and relics from across the world. She'd assumed it was all just set dressing and play acting, pretense at a storied lineage to make the members feel important, like the Masons with their secret handshakes and claims to ancient knowledge. She'd memorized stories about wars among incomprehensible entities, which she assumed were complex allegories, like the symbolic stories in the alchemy books she also studied. Sanford taught her phrases she was ordered to remember, though she could not understand them, drawn from extinct languages whose origins were unknown to her, Akkadian, and Aklo, and Bactrian, and Senzar. At first, her ceaseless intellectual curiosity was what drove her, but in time, she began to believe there might be real secrets here. Sanford, after all, was a wildly successful man who seemed to understand the world on a level Diana could only guess at, and she wanted that understanding for herself. Finally, after Sanford deemed her sufficiently suffused with esoteric knowledge, she was invited to a ceremony in a room of the lodge building she'd never seen before, one with red curtains on the walls and a red and white marble floor. She wore a dark hooded robe, and she was nervous, but did her best to keep her head high and hide her trembling. This was the first step on a long road to the top, to the inside, that theoretical place where people like Sanford dwelled, free from want and worry, directing their own destinies and the destinies of others, the place she wanted to be. Diana knelt on the stones, sipped something murky, wine she thought, but thickened, from a stone cup, and murmured an oath in Aklo. The air seemed charged, as if a thunderstorm were approaching, and her senses were strangely heightened. She could feel the hard marble beneath her knees, the cool air on her face, and every hair standing up on her arms. She was on the edge of something. Sanford, also robed and surrounded by other members of the lodge, said, "Do you pledge to faithfully pursue hidden knowledge, to aid your brothers and sisters in the order, and to make ours that which has been forbidden?"
"I will," she murmured.
Sanford touched her on each shoulder with a gnarled cane of black wood.
"I now pronounce you Seeker."
Then the lights came up and the hoods came down, and everyone congratulated her and clapped her on the back. She wasn't at the top, but she was no longer on the bottom either. She had her foot in the door. The new rank of Seeker gave her access to new parts of the lodge, including the Seeker's library, where those of her rank with a more scholarly bent were translating books Sanford or his agents had acquired. She'd idly flipped through them from time to time, finding most incomprehensible and the readable ones dull, until she'd opened a tome with a blank cover of greasy black leather and found her eyes assaulted by sigils in crusty red ink that still squirmed in her vision when she closed her eyes some nights. She'd avoided the library after that. Her new rank came not just with privileges, but with responsibilities. Sanford or his trusted lodge members often gave her tasks,
and she spent months going on errands she did not understand, accompanying higher-ranking lodge members and serving as a set of watchful eyes and useful hands. She was not permitted to ask questions on those errands, and so many of the things they did were baffling. Once, she'd sat in the stern of a rowboat while a bald man with a scarred face worked the oars and took them to the center of a perfectly circular pond in the Massachusetts countryside, where she was instructed to empty a small velvet pouch of what looked alarmingly like finger bones and teeth over the side. The fragments sank without causing any ripples, and they'd rowed silently back to shore and departed without incident. A month later, she'd joined two women in black hooded robes in a grove of thorny trees, who handed her a shovel with a silver blade. Diana dug a hole in the dirt until her shoulders screamed from the effort while they smoked cigarettes and shared a flask and chuckled, speaking in a language Diana didn't recognize. She'd finally struck a white root, as thick as her arm but slick and worm-like, and the women told her to climb out of the pit. They'd gone into the hole themselves, then, carrying a stone jug, poured what she hoped was wine, but suspected was diluted blood all over the root. After they made her refill the hole, they all left, the women chatting with her amiably about how her shop was doing, as if none of it had happened. She'd been sent to a burned farmhouse in western Massachusetts with a hawk-nosed man who wore a bandana on his head like a storybook pirate. They'd sorted through the rubble until they found a hatch that led to a cellar, and he'd descended. She waited above for half an hour, and then ruby light shone through the ash-streaked floorboards, and a droning sound that made her teeth ache emerged from below, before abruptly cutting off. The man emerged, sweaty and covered in dust and cobwebs, carrying a bulbous earthenware jar tucked under one arm. His bandana had slipped awry, and Diana stared at the hint of intricate red lines tattooed on his scalp until he snarled at her to get the car started and sent her scurrying away. By the time he joined her, he had adjusted the bandana and hidden the jar away in a valise, and said only that their excursion had been successful and the master would be pleased. Looking back, Diana was appalled at her own naivete. She'd found those missions exciting and sometimes scary, but even the latter had tantalized her with the promise of secret knowledge. Now she wondered what dark designs she'd played a part in. Even the strangest of those excursions were nothing compared to what she saw in the tunnels beneath the Silver Twilight Lodge itself after Carl Sanford decided she could be trusted with. Diana jumped at the sound of shattering glass. She looked down through the window, but didn't see anything in the alley behind the shop. Except, was that a flicker of movement? If there was someone down there breaking things, they were too close to the wall for her to see them, given the angle of her vantage. What if someone was breaking into the shop? She could call the police, but her telephone was downstairs, because she used it for business. She couldn't count on neighbors to notice a disturbance and call the authorities for her either. This part of Arkham kept firmly to business hours, and she was the only shopkeeper who lived on the premises, at least on this block. The sensible choice would be to lock and secure the door at the top of the stairs and wait things out. Confronting a potential burglar was a dangerous proposition. But after the horrors Diana had witnessed, the things she'd had a hand in bringing into this world, unwittingly or not, she was no longer inclined to be sensible. She felt helpless in the matter of the Silver Twilight Lodge and would not accept helplessness in her shop as well. Diana went to the corner and picked up an ebony walking stick, topped with a tarnished silver sphere. She'd found the stick among the jumble of items the former owner of Emmy's boutique had left behind when they fled town ahead of foreclosure. The heavy cane felt good in her hand, and she gave it a couple of experimental swings, satisfied that it would give any housebreaker pause. Then Diana opened the door and listened from the top of the stairs. She didn't hear more breakage, but was that someone singing? She moved down the stairs, which led to the back room of the shop, where her supplies and extra inventory were stored neatly on racks and shelves. A curtained archway separated this area from the front of the shop, but she didn't need to go out there. The noise had come from the alleyway out back. There were two windows in the back wall, far smaller than the great plate glass display windows out front, but still large enough for an intruder to crawl through. They were curtained for privacy and quite dirty on the outside, too. And neither window was broken. Not burglary, then. She listened at the window and heard a hoarse voice crooning.
"We will steer. We'll make them valleys ring, my boys. A drinking of strong beer."
Then a sort of coughing sob. Diana sighed. Not a burglar at all. Just some drunk, maybe a fisherman, since he was singing an old wailing song. She turned on the lights, then unbolted the back door and eased it open so she could tell him to move along. The moon shone down, bright and nearly full, illuminating the alley and turning the shattered whiskey bottle on the pavement into a glittering strew of diamonds. That explained the noise she'd heard. There was no reek of whiskey, which meant the bottle had been empty when her unwelcome visitor broke it. That was probably why he'd broken it. The man sat with his back to the wall of her shop and his legs extended straight out before him. He wore stained trousers with ragged hems at the ankles, a shirt with missing buttons, and a brown jacket with one sleeve dangling by threads. His left hand was wrapped in a handkerchief like was injured. He looked up at her, face ragged with stubble, eyes squinting, and she was surprised to see that he was relatively young, probably just in his 30s.
"An angel," he said. "You're radiant."
Diana frowned, then realized the light from inside the shop must have surrounded her with a backlit glow.
"You're drunk, and you're breaking things outside my shop. You should leave."
"I have nowhere to go."
He looked down at his bandaged hand. She felt sympathy for the poor man, but she had problems of her own.
"Nowhere is a big place, and you can choose to occupy some part of it that isn't right next to my back door."
"If they find me, I made them, but they hate me."
He struggled to his feet, leaning heavily against the door.
"I think they can sense me, but when I drink, it makes me blurry, changes the shape of me, so maybe they can't."
Diana started to go inside, content that he was about to move on, until he heard him say,
"But I can't risk going to the lodge, not if they can find me."
"What lodge?" Diana said.
He couldn't possibly mean her lodge, could he? Sanford would never give the time of day to a man like this. But maybe he hadn't always been like this. Maybe he'd seen things that had reduced him to this. She shivered at the thought. He looked at her, blinking, then shrugged.
"Silver. Silver Twilight Lodge. It's there. What's left of it. All that's left. And if my comets find it..."
He shook his head.
"That which when divided multiplies."
His words were all but incomprehensible, but tantalizing. What did this ruined man know about the Silver Twilight Lodge? Could it be something of use to her? She wanted to stop Sanford from performing his horrible rituals, from using the vulnerable for his own ends. But she had no idea how to go about that. Might this man know something to break the logjam in her mind and show her a path to action?
"Who are you?" Diana said.
"Who am I?"
he chuckled, a sound that was all fish hooks and bilge pumps.
"Abel Davenport, High priest laid low.
He shook his head, blinked at her, and frowned.
Who are you?
Diana Stanley. This is my shop.
Diana,
Abel said, and his smile was radiant.
The goddess of the hunt.
Then he closed his eyes and swayed, and only the fact that he swayed into the wall instead of away from it kept him upright.
Perhaps you'd better come inside, Diana decided.
Chapter 3. The Thief. Ruby Standish was in a place she wasn't supposed to be, and she was about to take something that didn't belong to her. There was nowhere else she'd rather be, and nothing else she'd rather be doing. The secret panel was just where her client had promised, hidden in the back of a walk-in closet behind a row of hanging suits. Her client didn't know the trick to opening the hidden door, so Ruby slipped a narrow-bladed knife from the sheath at her belt, and it slid into the crack beside the panel, moving it slowly up and down until she hit an obstruction. There was the latch. She grinned as she wiggled the blade, applying pressure, until there was a soft click, and the wall panel swung inward. She pushed it open all the way, half wincing in fear of an alarm. The old-timer she'd learned her craft from, Thorley, complained bitterly about the emergence of such devices in recent decades, especially the hidden switches that set off clanging bells. When Ruby set out to become a thief, she made a point of only learning from the successful ones. Thorley had never seen the inside of a jail cell, and that was one of Ruby's principal ambitions. Of course, one of Thorley's secrets was he stole mainly from people who wouldn't bother calling the law on you. They'd try to find you themselves instead. Dangerous people were, well, dangerous, but they also tended to get killed themselves, and then they'd stop looking, while the law was relentless. Ruby still exchanged the odd letter with Thorley, full of empty chatter and coded queries. One such letter had allowed him to connect Ruby with her current client. Thorley knew a lot of people who dabbled in the occult, and Ruby had gradually and almost accidentally eased into that realm as her area of expertise. There was a shocking number of rich collectors obsessed with paraphernalia from ancient civilizations, often rumored to possess impossible properties. Ruby thought most of the artifacts in circulation were fakes, but she knew some were real, or at least really strange. She still had the twisted scar around her left ankle to remind her there were things in the world she never particularly wanted to understand. No bells clanged, which meant her target trusted the building's security and the secrecy of his hiding space to protect his treasures. To be fair, most of the time they would have been ample defense. Getting into the lobby of an exclusive building like this, let alone up to the private penthouse that sprawled over the whole top floor, would have been tricky. Though with the right outfit and attitude, Ruby might have managed it. She'd smiled and charmed and batted her eyelashes into even better defended locations. The problem with that kind of approach, though, was that she'd be remembered by the doorman and security people, and with a target like this, you didn't want to give them any leads to pursue. Sometimes Ruby could be very memorable. Sometimes she could be a ghost. This was a ghost job. So she hadn't entered through the lobby. She'd come up the side of the building, dressed in black, a shadow on the wall, using pipes, ledges, crenellations, and all other ornamental foo-foo-rah the architects had kindly provided for her use. She had a slim metal tool for unfastening latches, but few people bothered to lock their windows when they were 6 stories high. Her target didn't even lock the French doors leading to his private terrace. A swift climb and an easy entry, just the way she liked it. The space beyond the secret panel was dark, and the beam from her small flashlight was just bright enough to fill the space with tantalizing glitters. Her client said there were lights in the hidden room, and with the closet door shut, she could turn those on safely without illuminating the apartment windows.
She felt around on the wall beyond the panel until she found the button and pushed it in. A chandelier dripping crystal teardrops began to glow in the ceiling overhead, illuminating the prettiest little secret showroom Ruby had ever seen. The place was small, only about 6 feet square, with a plush armchair in the center, arranged to offer a perfect view of the treasures arrayed on tables and shelves on the opposite wall. There were a couple of grotesque little statues carved of ebony and onyx, and she shuddered just glimpsing them. Things like that could be valuable to the right collector, but she'd cut her hand on a similar statue last year.
"It bit you,"
a stubborn voice whispered in the back of her mind. Her hand had swelled up like a hot water bottle, and she'd had a fever for 2 days afterward, full of nasty visions. She didn't like those little idols, and the pickings here were rich enough that she could afford to be superstitious. She passed over a gold scroll case that was too big to fit in the bag slung over her shoulder, but there was a necklace of black pearls that would fit nicely. And she also took a crude flute made from a length of scrimshawed bone and a stone jar made of lapis lazuli, smaller than her dainty fist. Her client hadn't mentioned those items, but he might want them anyway. And if not, there were always other interested parties.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.